5-Minute Church, I'm Pastor John. Welcome to Digging Deeper. We're doing a study in the book of Romans, and I believe this book will change your life. We're doing little small segments, so you don't have to worry, they're not going to be long messages. We're also doing little life bits. You can just jump in at any time. If you haven't joined us, welcome. Thank you for tuning in. And we're also looking at the bigger picture of Romans because I think the little things add up to a lot of big things. So today's life bit that I want you to walk away with is that God dreams bigger than you do. I believe that his dreams are much bigger than the dreams that you dream. And I know last week I shared a little bit about the crazy dreams. Hannah has had shoulder surgery, my wife, and she's been in incredible pain. And she's been on some pain meds, and those pain meds give her weird, crazy dreams. Well, now I think some of those crazy dreams have wore off on me because I'm having some weird dreams, and I usually don't even remember my dreams. But there's even crazier dreams that God has been given to me. And sometimes they're even harder to believe than the things that we dream in our minds. One of the things is that God has given me this dream, and he gave me this vision, this call in my life to preach Jesus to the masses, especially those that aren't believers, that don't go to church. He's given me this great desire, and he said that I'm going to be able to witness and share the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news of Jesus Christ, to a lot of people, especially those that have never heard it before. And the only problem is that he's spoken this to me in the past, and especially during a very difficult time in my life. One of the problems is that I was living in North Dakota at the time with only 125 people in town, okay? And so I'm like, well, how am I supposed to reach out to non-believers when there's only 125 people here and most of them go to some church because there's three churches in town? So it didn't make sense to me. Secondly, I was a pastor, and I've been caught up in sin, some of the sin that a lot of men struggle with, the sin of lust and pornography, and I was even arrested, and I was charged with some horrific crimes, and I lost everything. I lost my ministry, I lost my reputation, I lost my marriage as a result of that. And I was a single dad with three kids and trying to go through this whole thing. And God kept calling to me. He kept speaking two things to me. He said, the calling that I have, that dream he has for me, he said, it's irrevocable. When God dreams that upon us, when he gives that to us as his promise, that this is what he wants for your life, when he speaks those things upon your life, no matter what happens, they're not reversible. You can't sort of lose that favor, or God's promises now are nullified because of something that I've done or haven't done. And he says, he keeps calling, he goes, and it seems impossible. And the second thing is, he always says that John, your dreams are much too small and my dreams are much greater than yours. And he keeps speaking that in. And now if you fast forward it, it's been an amazing thing from where I was at, the different person that I was. I have an amazing wife who now was spoken the same vision of reaching lost people. Unbelievable. I'm so blessed to have her in my life. We've been able to travel all over the country and the world sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, the good news of the gospel, and getting it to people that normally wouldn't go to church. And this week, we're closing in now on over 12,000 active members, part of 5-Minute Church. That's part of God's dream, and I don't think that we're even seeing, we're just seeing the beginning. We're not seeing where even God is seeing this to go, but I know we're getting on phones that people are struggling in the middle of the night, that are losing hope. We're getting on people's phones that would never go to church or feel judged by going to church, and we're able to speak truth and life to them wherever they're at, and that's an amazing thing. And so what is my role in this dream, okay? What is my role? My role is simply to have faith, which is everything, faith in what God has spoken into my life, but also to have hope that God wants the best for his children, for us. It seems simple, but it's not, because Satan likes to attack those two things, our faith and our hope. He loves to attack your faith, remind you of your faithlessness to God, that our failures and our struggles and all the things that we are, that are horrible about who we are. And even Paul says, there's no one righteous, not even one. That we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God that we looked at last week. But he also attacks our hope and reminds you that there's impossibilities. Just this week, I was even challenged by that, by a news reporter that the story's getting out that the 5-Minute Church is growing. This news reporter talked to us, and instead of focusing on what's happening with 5-Minute Church and this phenomenon that's going out, and we're reaching this next generation that is pouring out of churches, and yet all she wanted to do is focus on my past and my failures and the things that I'm ashamed of, the things that I've had to work through with counseling and with accountability and those things that I'm now helping other men who struggle in those areas find freedom that I have today. But yet all she wanted to do was focus on the negative and not the positive, what God was speaking and doing in my life. But what does God have to say about that? In Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, it says, "What then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, discovered in this matter? If in fact Abraham was justified by works," or what he did, "he had something to boast about, but not before God. What does the scripture say? That Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness." See, Abraham had a dream. He wanted to have children. But his dream was even too small, because God takes him on top of this hill and he promises Abraham. He said, "Abraham, you're going to be the father of many nations. And you look at all the stars," and he shows him the stars in the sky, and he says, "You'll have more descendants than you can count, the stars in the sky." What an amazing thing. Amazing promise of God. Abe's like, "Hey, I just want to have kids. That's all I want, to help work my sheep." And God is like, no, you don't understand. You're going to be the father of many nations. But there's a problem. The problem is that he's 100 years old and he has no kids. And it's not a funny, but when God speaks, it's not a joke to God. When God promises and when he wants to dream big things for you, it's not a joke, even though it looks absolutely impossible. And Abe didn't always do the right things. In fact, he got impatient and he had a kid with the maidservant, which was a total mess in his home with Ishmael. He had struggles of doubt. Even his wife, when she did find out that she was pregnant in her old age, she laughed when she found out, because it just seemed ridiculous that now in their old age, that how could he be the father of many nations? But you're missing the point. It wasn't what Abraham did. It was what he believed. And he believed, and God said he credited that as righteousness. He did not do the right thing. He did not say the right things. He believed God, and that was it. It was his faith. And in verse 18 of chapter 4, it says, "Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations, just as it is said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. That is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words 'it was credited to him' were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, he was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification." Abraham, all he did, what seems simple, but it's a lot harder to do, is that against all hope, he had hope. Without weakening his faith, did you see that? Without weakening his faith, he believed. And he did not waver regarding the promises of God, even when he was 100 years old. And he was fully persuaded. I love that. Fully persuaded means that there was no doubt that God has the power to do it. And he said, it's not just for Abraham, it's for us. It's kind of like my dad. My dad had this unbelievable faith in station wagons. Unbelievable. My dad loved station wagons. He believed in them. He figured that, you know what? I don't need a pickup truck. I don't need a Suburban. I need a station wagon. That's the way we haul 6 people in our family. This is what we pull our almost 30-foot travel trailer around the country singing. The Herbly Family singers would sing all over the place. And he had unbelievable faith in station wagon. And our first station wagon died. And so we were going to get a new one, and my grandparents were going to help us out. Instead of getting like a Suburban, which were kind of cool at the time, that could actually pull the trailer, he decided to get another station wagon. But this was like the Wally wagon, the step up. It had the wood paneling. Ended up painting it mauve, because my mom loved mauve. And we would take this thing all over the country. My dad had unbelievable faith. We went thousands and thousands of miles. But the problem is this thing was hardly pulled this camper, especially going up passes. And I remember we would all just have to be super quiet. Quiet, we're going up a pass. Dad has to hear the car. My mom would get all mad. And my dad had so much faith. This thing, I'm serious, was barely creeping. There was one pass. We actually got up and kind of like was pushing on the back of the trailer to get it over the pass. And my dad had such faith. And I'm like, Dad, why don't you get a new one? He's like, no, this is the car that God had given and had blessed our family with. And so he believed in it. And you know what? That car took us everywhere. And my dad kept it up until a few years ago. He still kind of had it around because I can haul plywood in it. A whole sheet of plywood fits in the back and I can do all this stuff. And he still had it around. And I wanted to have it enter it as a demolition derby for our church because the station wagons are awesome in demolition derbies. I'm like, Dad, let's just go out in a style. Let's just have everybody there and we'll just bury the Wally wagon in front of a lot of people. And he goes, no way. He still believed in it. He gave it to a single mom with kids. He wouldn't even let me take it. He gave it away and blessed somebody else with it. See, if you want to impress God, if you want to make an impression on God, it's not in doing the right things and having a shiny car like everybody thinks you have to have. It's believing in the right things, not doing the right things, because none of us can do the right things all the time. But it is believing in the right things. It's taking what he's giving you and pulling it up the hill. Even when it seems that there's no way, the burdens, the life, it seems impossible that this mountain pass, but what God has given you, take and believe in it, because your dreams seem impossible, but his are much bigger. So how are we righteous? It says, how do we get righteousness? Because without righteousness, we can't see God and we can't have eternal life. If we have sin in our life, it's not atoned for through the blood of Jesus Christ. It's not by doing enough good things. It's not our good things outweigh our bad things. If we get into heaven, it's faith in Jesus Christ. As it says that Abraham's faith was credited as righteousness, and our faith is our righteousness. But see, if Satan can steal your faith and your hope, he steals your dreams and your ticket to eternity. I close with this, is that against all hope, Abraham, in hope, believed. Friends, if you feel like there's no hope and your faith is wavering, it's time you dream bigger. Dream the dream that God has given you. Use what he has given you and pull it up the hill. We're praying for you. We love you. If we can do anything to help you and support you, we're your pastors, and we're here for you no matter what. We're praying for you in faith. Believe in God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. Ask him to confess your sins to him, and he will forgive your sins. And in your faith, you will gain righteousness. God bless you. Have a great week. Go in peace. Thanks for tuning in.